For whatever reason, in this country, when it comes to paying for college, we seem to have it backwards. We send our kids to school and then we figure out how to pay for it. I have a novel idea. What if instead of doing that, we figure out how to pay for it and then send our kids to college?
Oh, that's smart. So smart.
And look, I understand we don't want to trample on our kids' dreams. We don't want to upset teenagers, which already tend to be a little bit hormonal anyway. So instead, what we do is we say, yes, we'll figure it out. We'll understand how we can do this. And let's just see if we can take out loans and insane amounts of debt. That way we can make sure that everybody's happy. But the problem is you're hurting your future self if you do this. There's typically two ways in which people take out loans. The first one will be private loans, which can be taken out in the student's name, or you can take out parent plus loans, which are taken out in the parent's name. Either way, you don't want to put yourself in a position where it's insurmountable and it's going to trample on other goals. So instead, what we're going to focus on today is the proper way that you can take out a Parent Plus loan. If we haven't met yet, I'm Danny Sinowitz, and I hate student loans more than the average young dad hates animated Disney movies. And while paying for college is no fairy tale, I can assure you that there is a best way in which you can pay for college, but you need to make sure that you have the right strategy to do so. Today, the strategy we're going to be talking about is how to best pay with Parent Plus loans. And look, the reason why Parent Plus loans are looked down upon so much by folks is because Parent Plus loans can be borrowed up to the full cost of attendance, and the amount of underwriting that takes place is minimal. So a lot of parents have found themselves in a position where they have these massive balances to repay. And when they're getting close to retirement, they say, there's no way that I can do it. I got to pay $1,600, $1,700, $1,800 a month just so I can actually repay my kids' tuition that I took out years ago. It's not a sustainable way to do it, but honestly, there's a better way to do it. What you need to realize is there are certain types of income-driven repayment plans that you can hop on to make sure that you're able to both retire and be able to pay off an education loan at the same time. Let's first start with a fundamental understanding. Student loans are different than your average debt. If you tune into Dave Ramsey's show, a lot of times people may be calling in with mortgages, with car loans, with personal loans, with credit card debt. That type of debt is a lot different than student loans. Why? Well, federal student loans have a couple different criteria. Number one, to actually apply for them, it's a lot different than it would be if you're applying for a credit card or a personal loan. When it comes to personal loan or credit card, the amount of underwriting that takes place is going to be it. They're going to run your credit. They're going to make sure that you are in position that you can repay. Credit worthiness and underwriting is going to take place for these types of loans because they're done by private companies. Well, Parent Plus loans are actually taken out from the Department of Education. So what exactly is adverse credit history? Well, you can check it out in the Department of Education's definitions, and I'm linking to that in the description below so that you're aware of what that looks like. But the two other things that are really different with student loans, specifically federal student loans, is the way that the repayment process works and the way that the forgiveness option works. For a mortgage, I'm not aware of really any type of forgiveness option that's out there. The repayment options are pretty straightforward. Same with car loans, same with credit card debt. Unless you were to enter into something like bankruptcy, typically speaking, these loans are going to need to be repaid by qualified borrowers. But student loans can be a lot different. You see, repayment plans are going to be dependent on things such as tax filing status, your employer that you work for, the actual discretionary income that you're bringing in. All of this can then have an effect on how much you actually have to repay inside your student loan. So if you're planning to pay for your child's education, you're planning to use a Parent Plus loan, you got to make sure you follow a couple of basic steps. So what exactly are they? Number one, you first need to figure out a budget to pay for school. How do you figure out a budget to pay for school? Well, we previously did a video on that. There are five sources we typically recommend. Check out that video if you're unfamiliar or you haven't yet built out a budget. Once you have built out that budget, though, you then are going to basically have a number in which you can say, all right, this is how much we can reasonably afford for an out-of-pocket expense. Once you have that figured out, the next thing that you got to do is make sure that you run the net price calculator of the schools on your list. The net price calculator is important because sticker price at each college is going to be pretty much the number that they lead with. $85,000 to go to Harvard, $80,000 to go to Notre Dame, whatever those numbers are. But typically that's not necessarily what each middle class family is going to have to pay. You see, they're going to award some level of financial aid through the school. They may give you some other type of institutional aid. There could be something to knock down that actual net price of college. Assuming you do knock that net price of college down, What you then are going to have is your bottom line number. There's going to be a gap between what you can afford and what the net price is going to be each year. Generally speaking, families, specifically middle class families, have been able to fill this gap with loans. Now, the loans are going to vary. A lot of families take out private loans. Some of them find a way to take out loans from family members. But one way that you can look to take these out are Parent PLUS loans. Parent PLUS loans are federal direct loans through the federal direct system. So they are going to have a lot of similarities, but there are some differences than what you would notice from those Stafford loans, those direct loans, which are in the student's name only that they can repay. So how do you make sure that you're in a position or that you're qualified to take out a Parent PLUS loan and that you could be in a position to then say, okay, well, I can actually pay these back? The first thing you want to do is to make sure that you are actually qualified. So again, check out that Department of Education link to make sure that you're actually qualified and you don't have adverse credit history. Assuming you don't, you then want to look to see what the gap will be. So you can actually borrow up to the full cost of attendance when applying to a school. So for example, if you're looking to go to Harvard, and let's say that the amount of aid that you're going to get is $30,000, but the cost of attendance is going to be $80,000, well, there's going to be a $50,000 gap in which you have there. So you're going to need to fill that gap somehow. What Parent PLUS loans will allow you to do is you can fill that gap fully with Parent PLUS loans, again, assuming that you're qualified. So take that number 5, multiply it by 4, assuming that that's what your child is going to go to school for the next 4 years. That's going to give you $200,000 of Parent PLUS loan debt. This may be an extreme example, but you can check out plenty of other sources which will show Parent PLUS loans oftentimes are going to be 6 figures when it comes to the amount of the balance itself. If and when they are, you could have a problem if you don't have a proper way to repay. So now that we have a 4-year number, or at least a projected 4-year number, we then want to understand what is the actual repayment going to be. And this is where we're going to see a lot of variance amongst middle-class families. What you then need to do is actually understand what your adjusted gross income is. There are ways in which you can lower your adjusted gross income, such as contributing to pre-tax retirement accounts. So if you have a picture of where you're at income-wise and you back out some of those top-line deductions there, such as 401k contributions, HSA contributions, or maybe if you're contributing to a pension plan, if all those things are then accounted for, you're then going to have your adjusted gross income. What the Department of Education then allows for is they have 4 different types of income-driven repayment plans. For Parent PLUS loans, there is actually some access to all 4, but there's a roundabout way to get to the 3 other ones that are available. For most Parent PLUS loan borrowers, especially ones that are going to be borrowing now and that are going to continue to borrow for a couple years into the future, the current one that's going to be available to you is the Income Contingent Repayment Plan. So the way that you can actually figure out what your repayment will be is by plugging this information into calculators. So the one that I like to use is savingforcollege.com, but there are 2 things that you need to make sure of before you actually do this calculation. The first one that you want to be looking into is your tax filing status. So for the majority of married couples, the tax filing status that they're going to actually look to use is the married filing jointly tax status. And there are plenty of good reasons why. You're eligible for many more credits if you use the tax filing status, married filing jointly. You're eligible for certain types of retirement plans, such as a Roth IRA. Whereas if you go the married filing separately route, these options usually become limited, or there's a certain income threshold that really decreases to be eligible for certain things like Roth IRA contributions. But if you're married filing separately on the income contingent repayment plan, this repayment plan is only going to be considering the spouse's income who has the loans who've taken them out. So for example, if one spouse is making $100,000 and another spouse is making $50,000, combined it's $150,000 of adjusted gross income. But if the spouse who's making $50,000 takes the loan out, then you're only going to have to consider that when actually completing this calculation. So the $50,000 is the amount that you plug in. And you then are able to repay if you're married filing separately on that income contingent repayment plan with just the one spouse's income that's included. From there, the other thing that's really important to understand is which type of employer are you working for? Are you working for an employer who would qualify you under public service loan forgiveness? If you have questions on that, again, check out the link in the description. We've linked to the certain types of employers which public service loan forgiveness covers. But basically speaking, nonprofits, government employees, those are going to be the ones that that are eligible for public service loan forgiveness. That decreases the amount of work that you actually need to be having to up to 10 years, 120 qualifying payments. It doesn't need to be cumulative, but it does need to be 120 qualifying payments where you are working for an employer who is qualified full time. And assuming you do so and you make those 120 qualifying payments, you could have your full balance forgiven. But what you want to be aware of, though, if you're taking out a Parent PLUS loan is, again, you do need to consolidate that Parent PLUS loan and then go on to one of the income-driven repayment plans. Again, more than likely, it's going to be that income contingent repayment plan that you're eligible for. But what you also need to keep in mind is that there's the 4 years of undergrad that your child may be going for, and then there's the 10 years that actually will start that repayment, because you have to consolidate that Parent PLUS loan before you're actually able then to get onto public service loan forgiveness and the schedule actually starting. So be sure that you want to make sure that you time up. If you have more than 14 years to work in a public service job, you're not planning to leave that public service job, and you then have a child that's going in now, it could time up where it could make some sense. But you don't just want to be tied to a job strictly for the reason of public service loan forgiveness. There are ways that you can strategize to make sure that you get those 10 years. But if retirement's coming up in the next year or two for you, it might not be the best thing to do. If you do have any further questions on this, there is a link to my calendar in the description below. Feel free to grab some time on my calendar so we can discuss your specific situation, see if we're a fit. Otherwise, though, the information presented in this video is meant to be educational in nature and is not meant to be taken as specific recommendations. If you have specific questions, be sure to reach out to your tax professional, your attorney, or your financial planner, who will better be able to answer your specific questions and take this information, apply it to your situation. If you haven't done so yet, now is a great time to subscribe to the channel. You will be kept in the loop with other great information when it comes to paying for college, paying back loans, and financial information in general. I'll catch you in the next video. Until next time.